Hope everyone's doing well. Welcome to the Majia Mindset. Today's guest is an absolute honor. He has worked as an assistant coach and a consultant in several World Cups for the Russian national team, South Korean national team, as well as the Holland national team. Has worked alongside legendary coaches such as Goose Hiddink, Louis van Gaal, and the late Gary Speed with the Welsh national team. He is currently the CEO and founder of World Football Academy. His FC Evolution company is currently offering online mentorship to better enhance our beautiful game. It is my absolute pleasure to welcome our guest, Raymond Verheyen. Roll the intro.
How are you doing?
How are you?
Good. I appreciate you putting in the time to join us on the Majia Mindset. It is truly an honor and a pleasure to have you.
Yeah. Nice flag. Did you do that on purpose or is the flag always there?
No, we've always had this. I know we're having you on as a guest, but there's an infatuation of obviously philosophy behind Ajax. I love the philosophy behind Ajax as well as the Barcelona and the grandfather behind it with Johan Cruyff. Everybody has a style. That's kind of like the style that I kind of grew up admiring as a player and then later as a coach as well. And then the way I see the game. But
okay, good.
So wanted to kind of start the dialogue in. It's funny how we're talking about Ajax and philosophy. Wanted to start the conversation and dialogue with coaching philosophy and coaching style. First, we wanted to kind of discuss your view on it, your coaching style, your coaching philosophy, and then how does one establish one? How does one end up finding, you know, this is my coaching style. This is a philosophy that helps me be successful. Is it everyone trying to find their own? How do they come upon it? But if we can first start with your personal philosophy and style.
Yeah, what is important with questions like this is that you create a very clear reference first. And you have to distinguish two different things. On the one hand, you have objective football knowledge that is true for everybody, because knowledge based on the game is the same for everybody because everybody is playing that same game or everybody is coaching that same game. And on the other hand, besides the objective football knowledge, you have the subjective application of that knowledge. And your subjective application basically means that you are applying the objective knowledge, but that you also have to anticipate on the external factors in your situation. Are you coaching women or are you coaching men? Are you coaching adults or are you coaching children? Are you coaching amateurs or are you coaching professionals? In what culture are you coaching? Do you train every day or do you train two or three times a week? And when you train, do you have a full pitch available or do you only have half a pitch or quarter of a pitch available? And you have an endless number of external factors that you have to anticipate on back home in your environment. And that is what you call subjective application. So objective knowledge is the same for everybody. And subjective application is different for everybody because everybody is working in a different situation and therefore anticipating on more or less different external factors. So your question has to do with the personal component. And the personal component has nothing to do with the knowledge part, because that's the same for everybody. The personal component has to do with the subjective application. And another component, another influence on your subjective application is, for example, your personality. Are you an introvert person? Are you an extrovert person? Are you somebody who is verbally very strong or not so strong? So all these components together determine your way of coaching, and that is the how. Yeah? The football knowledge is the what. That is what you apply. And your coaching style is how you apply it. And there is no advice to anyone other than do what your intuition tells you and don't copy the subjective application, the coaching style of somebody else. Because unfortunately, that is happening all around the world a lot. What you would expect is that everybody is sharing objective knowledge with each other. Yeah, and that everybody is downloading objective knowledge in his brain. That is what you would hope. What is unfortunately happening is that everybody is sharing their subjective application with each other. So everybody is sharing their how, their way of doing things. But that's very personal. So if I listen to a presentation of somebody who is, for example, working at Chelsea, I am listening to somebody who is subjectively applying knowledge in a way, anticipating on external factors that I don't have. And I'm listening to somebody who is solving problems that I don't have. And I'm listening to somebody coaching based on a personality that I don't have. Still, people are copying what they're listening to. So they are copying somebody's how. But somebody's how is very personal. You should copy the what. So you should listen to what somebody says. Ignore the how, because that is very personal to that person. But you should try to extrapolate the what, the intentions, the underlying knowledge, the logical thinking, the objective facts. Like I said, unfortunately, that's not happening. So people are sharing their subjective how with each other. People are copying somebody else's subjective how, and then they are going to subjectively apply somebody else's subjective application. Well, in normal life, subjectivity times subjectivity is called chaos. Yeah, and it's the same in football. Yeah, so the only thing you can do is download knowledge, and knowledge in your brain, and then wait what pops up. Mm. And then trust what pops up. Mm. And the more objective the knowledge in your brain, and the more knowledge you have in your brain, the bigger the chance that something good pops up. Mm. Yes? So I think that would be my answer, my suggestion. Don't copy somebody else. Download knowledge, objective knowledge, so information that you can trust. Download as much reliable information as possible, because the more objective the information, the more you can trust whatever thought pops up, and then develop your own coaching style.
Raymond, that's such a beautiful answer. That's such a great perspective, because I think we tend to forget originality, originality is so key in every coaching style and how to establish your own. You know, obviously getting different perspective, getting other knowledges and reflecting on it and then putting it into your own. So I appreciate you sharing that. It's so important. And it kind of transitions me to my kind of point A of our still first part question about coaching style and philosophy is you worked with a very well-renowned coach in Goose Hiddink with Russia as well as other teams along the path. And you've seen his coaching style at the international platform as well. I wanted to kind of discuss when you were working with Goose Hiddink and being a part of that coaching staff, some of the things that our viewers don't see when you're dealing at that level, at that elite level and coaching at the international level. What is it that you have to establish within, yes, the coaching style, but culture, the culture? And you kind of touched on it. It depends on what type of players you have, okay? Can we talk about key aspects that one Goose Hiddink incorporated in and what you guys worked together in establishing those culture and having successful teams? You guys went to national teams and had successful moments. You guys were competitive. You guys had a culture. You guys had a belief, a playing style that was effective. What made it become like that at that level?
Well, the most important thing is that every time that Coach Hiddink signed a contract with a, for example, a national team or a club in a certain country, that every time when I was sitting down with him at his house to discuss the preparation for that team or whatever, always I saw books in his office about that country, about the culture of that country. And he went even one step further. Because, for example, in preparation for the World Cup 2010, he even had books of South Africa, and he was studying the culture in South Africa, not because he was working with South African players, because he was working with another country, but because he wanted to understand the underlying mechanisms of the culture, the behaviors of people in South Africa, so that he could understand the situation around him better during the tournament, and that he could also make use of certain situations when they happen, because that is his strength. The mistake that a lot of coaches often make is that they try to squeeze things through the throat of the players, or they talk endlessly to players. So they think that by talking and developing comprehension, then based on that comprehension, the players will become competent. Mm. So a lot of people think that comprehension precedes competence. And what he understands is that comprehension does not precede competence. Comprehension evolves when competence develops. Yes. I always use the metaphor that when you sit down with a teenager of which you see is about to make a mistake, when you explain to that teenager that he should not do something because it's going wrong, the teenager is probably going to look at you like, what are you talking about? It has no meaning for the child yet. So, the child first has to experience it, and then when the teenager makes the mistake, and then you sit down with the teenager, based on that experience, your words now have a meaning, and now you can develop comprehension. And now you have a chance that the teenager is not going to make the mistake again. Yeah, so you need that experience, you need that situation first before the teenager develops comprehension. So then experience, the competence or the incompetence, precedes comprehension with the teenager. Instead of talking, yeah, everybody understand? Okay, let's play. Yeah, that's also how it works at schools. Blah, 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 blah. Everybody understand? Okay, now you're competent. No, it doesn't work like that. So, what does that mean, this knowledge that I just described? Now, as a coach, you need an extra sense to spot situations that happen and that you then can use to develop comprehension or consciousness. So basically what Coach Hiddink is always doing, he is just observing, he is identifying incompetencies, but he's not immediately jumping on it and then talk. No, he sees incompetencies and then he is just waiting for a situation where this incompetence is exposed, and then he uses it to develop comprehension, ideally in front of everybody, because now he can influence all 20 brains rather than only one player. Or, and that now we go one step further, sometimes he even helps nature a little bit. So now he's not going to wait for a situation to use and to develop comprehension in his players. He is going to design, top-down design, a situation that is going to provoke the desired competent or incompetent behavior. A classic example, when we were working with Korea, when we reached the semi-final in the World Cup in 2002. Before that World Cup, he saw that the team was too old. There were too many old players. But those players were very popular. If he had let them go, the public opinion would be against him immediately. So what did he do? He created a situation that would provoke the incompetent, old behavior of those players. How did he do that? Friendly game against Brazil. Friendly game against France. Friendly game against the Czech Republic, who were very good in those years. 5-0 loss. 5-0 loss and 5-0 loss. So 3 times 5-0. So his nickname became Mr. 5-0, by the way. So your position must be very strong to be able to afford this approach. But anyway, so, and he let those old players play for 90 minutes. Yes. Which is too long at such a high level. And then everybody saw, hey, these players look old. We will never be successful in the World Cup if with these players. So now he created the situation where the incompetent, the too old behavior of those players was provoked. It was exposed. Now the public opinion was, hey, these players are too old. And then he was able to replace them with younger players. And this is what you call situation coaching. So you are not coaching with words, but you are coaching with situations. And yeah, that is one of the strengths of this coach.
Wow! I think that's such a valuable point in that you just elaborated on. And you know, a lot of it. It's funny. A lot of it didn't have to do with X's and O's. Didn't have to do with X's and O's, but understanding culture and where you're going into and setting up environments to get the buy-in. The buy-in is so important for coaches. If it's a buy-in from players, if it's a buy-in from the government, if it's a buy-in from the country, if it's a buy-in from the people, to give you that time to implement your style, to implement your philosophy. I think that's the thing is, okay, this is my philosophy. But if I go with this group long-term is not going to be my group. So what you just established was he needed to do a point to prove to them this is not that group. And then it allows him to bring those players in to incorporate that. That was so vital, and I appreciate you sharing that. Where it kind of transitions us to our next quick question, and it's an area that you are very strong in voicing your opinion on, and it's your field as well, with periodization, and how periodization has evolved within our game. And I really love this topic just because we see coaches that really use it and take it seriously, because my personal opinion, if it's one-on-one training, Raymond, or if it's a team environment, if a player gets hurt, I think a coach really first needs to evaluate that environment they created. Okay, why did that player get hurt? Is it on the personal of the player, or is it the coach? And we've seen it sometimes, you're like, oof, you're watching a training and you're like, man, did they really properly test it? Did they properly build up to that? And what I mean by that is you're getting a player group in training camp. Maybe they're coming off their vacation, their whole group. You don't know what level you're getting them in. And right away, you're going into 2-hour session. You're going intense, hitting. And you don't know the balance of that. So I want to kind of touch in, how has the modern game evolved in incorporating periodization? How has, and also talking about the small-sided games, technical work on the ball versus running without the ball, doing activities without the ball in periodization? And I want to kind of touch base in your point of view on that. What is it that's going to allow you, if you're coming in as a coach and you're like, this is how I got it periodized, to get my team fit, to get my individual fit, but in the end of the day, they're footballers. Get them fit, but get them technically, tactically ready to perform at the highest level, at an elite level.
Well, basically, you touch on two things, the football periodization and football fitness. One misperception is that people sometimes think that football periodization is the same as football fitness, which is not true. Because football fitness is only part of it. Football periodization is the periodization of football. That's basically what it says. Football periodization means the periodization of football. And the periodization of football means the periodization of all the components in football. And fitness is only one of the components. So football fitness training is only an integral part of football periodization, and not the same as football periodization. So football periodization relates to football fitness the way fruit relates to apples. So that is already one thing to make clear. And then the next thing that is important is, what is the definition of football periodization, and in particular periodization? Well, the meaning of periodization is that you try to optimize the training effects of training exercises within a session or a session as a whole. In other words, that you take the maximum out of a training session. And why does that not always happen, taking the maximum out of a session, is because of fatigue. Accumulation of fatigue is often spoiling the party. So you are working really hard, but because you are tired, you are not working at 100%. you are working at 80%, but when you are working at 80%, you will not reach 101% because you are well within the boundaries, so you are not improving. So fatigue is often spoiling the party in terms of developing training effects. So first of all, within one training session, obviously sometimes you accumulate fatigue because you want to stretch boundaries. So accumulation of fatigue within one session itself does not have to be a problem, as long as it doesn't happen at the wrong moment. If you accumulate fatigue big time already in the first half of the training session, then it's a problem, because then the second half of the training session you can throw in the bin, because you are so tired already halfway that the quality of whatever you're going to do next is going to be below par. So you are just basically keeping your players busy, playing slow football at 80%, and they are not going to stretch boundaries anymore. So accumulation of fatigue within one training session is fine, as long as it takes place at the end, so that it doesn't take, so it doesn't have a negative influence on all the other components within that session. And the second thing is that accumulation of fatigue should not have a negative effect on the quality of the subsequent training sessions, for example, the next day. Because you can push a player to the limits today, but if that means that the quality of training tomorrow is relatively low, then basically you lose one training session. Yeah, so then maybe you should plan tomorrow's training session, not tomorrow, but the day after. Yes. So that is from a performance point of view, from a training effect point of view. And the other reason why you have to plan those spikes of fatigue carefully is from an injury prevention point of view. Because if you accumulate fatigue, your nervous system will become slower. So the signal from your brain to your muscles arrives later. And it might mean that normally you turn around or you decelerate, and the muscles around your knee contract and they stabilize your knee. And as a result, your upper leg and your lower leg and the bones are stabilized. They stay in place. But if you accumulate fatigue and your nervous system gets slower and the signal from your brain to the muscles around the knee arrives a little later, you are already rotating or decelerating while the muscles around your knee have not contracted yet. So now your knee is not stable. And now the two bones start to move in relation to each other. And that is what you call an ACL injury. So accumulation of fatigue is fine at the end of the training session, and as long as players get enough time to get rid of the fatigue and to regain their freshness before the next training session. Yes. If coaches do not understand those principles of periodization, they will end up training with players or playing games with players who are still tired from the previous training session, playing football with a slower nervous system, and then somebody snaps his ACL, and then the classic reaction is, bad luck. There was no opponent close to him. It was a very innocent action. Very unlucky. No. He is not unlucky. It's not bad luck. It is accumulation of fatigue. Slower nervous system. The signal arrived too late to the knee. The muscles contracted too late. The knee was stabilized too late. So it's not bad luck. It is incompetent coaching. So football periodization is, on the one hand, optimizing the training effect of exercises and sessions. And secondly, reducing the negative effects of accumulation of fatigue and slowing down the nervous system.
No, that's so important. It's funny how you're on the ACL perspective, because I actually was one of those coaches that would say, oh, that's bad luck. You know, and it's funny the way you're establishing that perspective, because I'm like, you know what? When I reflect on the moments that I've had players that blown out their lead at the collegiate level, at certain levels, and even at the professional level, you're like, you're right. You're right. It's been a longer part of the season. It was towards the end of the game. The fatigue has kicked in, and we should have been evaluating the certain parts of those moments throughout. What I'm going to kind of get into now, since we're kind of discussing it, is what should be the priority? Should it be injury prevention? Should it be strengthening? Should it be building muscle? Should it be focusing on speed when you're working on developing the individual in their overall performance of the game? What should, as a coach, we be focusing on? In the end of the day, they got to go out there and play football. That's the game. We're not developing track stars. We're not developing certain aspects. We're developing footballers. So what is it that we're focusing on the performance part to allow them to be maximizing their performance?
Yeah, obviously the core business is developing the football ability. Mm-hmm. Yes. And then when you overload the football ability to improve the football ability, you should do that based on the principles of periodization to avoid negative side effects like we just discussed. So the football periodization, the principles, that is the injury prevention, or I should say, injury reduction, because you can't prevent, you are reducing the chance. So the first question, to go back to football ability, somebody's football ability should be defined first, very clearly and objectively. So we should analyze the football situation, but not based on our opinion, but based on what is literally happening in front of us. And what is happening in front of us is football players interacting with the football environment. Yeah, so those football interactions, football actions, is what we are observing. Yeah, passing, pressing, creating space, shooting. They are all football interactions, football actions. And those football actions can be defined in more detail, because there are different phases chronologically within that football interaction. Yes? If I have the ball and you are my teammate, before we decide to do anything, we are first of all communicating with each other. We are exchanging information. I am sending information to you. You are perceiving that. You are sending information to me. I am perceiving that. And this exchange of information between the two of us, and also everybody else on the pitch and everything else on the pitch, that is what you call communication. Yeah. So communication is the first phase of a football interaction, a football action. And based on that communication, that exchange of information, you then make a decision. So decision making is the second phase of a football action. And then after making a decision, you execute a decision. So execution of a decision is the third phase of a football interaction. So a football action is communication, decision, and execution. CDE. Yeah. And my football ability means my ability to communicate, my ability to make decisions, and my ability to execute those decisions. Yes. That is my football ability. That is how good I am. How good I am in passing the ball once. My 100%. Or my ability to press once. My 100%. That is my football ability. But I am not Usain Bolt. I don't have to make one action and then finish. If that's the case, I only need football ability. I have to make one top interaction finish. No, I must be able to perform those interactions hundreds of times. And that is what you call football fitness. Football fitness is, first of all, performing football actions as frequently as possible so that I can play with a higher tempo in the first half. So, more actions per minute. That is the first football fitness characteristic. The second football fitness characteristic is that I must be able to maintain good football actions. I must be able to maintain good communication, maintain good decision making, and maintain good execution of decisions. And the third and final football fitness characteristic is my ability to maintain many football actions, many communication, many decision making, many execution of decisions at the end of the game. So, football ability is better action, better passing, in terms of better communication, better decision making, and better execution of decisions. So that is football ability. And football fitness is more actions per minute and maintaining good actions and maintaining many actions in the second half. And thanks to this, let's say, philosophical reference, now I can answer every single question that you just asked, because you asked multiple questions. Also, for example, should we focus on performance or injury prevention? Or should we focus on training in football situations or in an isolated way? All these questions I can now answer in an objective way. So not based on my opinion, not based on my preference, not based on my past experience. No, based on a philosophically sound definition of football in general, and football ability, and football fitness in particular. Yeah. And that means that it is football performance is the rule, and yes, we can also, as an exception on the rule, focus on injury prevention. Training in the football context is the rule, because only in the football context will there be interactions with the football context, and will there be communication, decision-making, and execution of a decision. Isolated training is the exception on the rule. Yeah, so we are not going to say this is right, this is wrong, or this yes and this no. No, because there is place for isolated training, yeah, but as an exception on the rule. Yeah, the rule is the football context, because football is communication, decision, and execution. And if there are no opponents, I am not communicating with my opponent. I don't make decisions. I am only executing in an isolated situation. So if a football action has three characteristics, communication, decision, execution, and in an isolated situation, two of those three characteristics are missing, communication and decision making, then we are not training football anymore. Yes? If something has three characteristics and then two of the three characteristics are missing, is the something now still the something, or has the something now become something else? And asking the question is answering the question. Yes? So if all three components are there, communication, decision, execution, the something, football, action is still the something. If two of the three characteristics, communication and decision making, are missing, the something, football, is not the something anymore. It has become something else. Yes? And it doesn't mean that the something else does not contribute to football, because it could contribute to football. But we should not call it football. Yes? So, if there are opponents, I call it passing. Yeah, then I'm training passing, communication, decision, execution. But when the opponent is away and I'm training in an isolated situation, I am not passing anymore, because passing is a football action. A football action has three characteristics. Two of the three characteristics are missing. So now it's not a football action anymore. So it's not passing anymore. I am now not passing. I am kicking a ball. Yes? In a football context, you call it creating space. In an isolated situation, you call it sprinting. In a football situation, you call it passing, communication, decision, execution. In an isolated situation, you call it kicking. The same with goalkeeper coach, goalkeepers. In a football situation, I am intercepting a cross, communication, decision, execution. In an isolated situation, I am catching a ball that happened to come from the sideline. You see? So, on the one hand, it sounds very simple what I'm saying. But on the other hand, you probably also recognize that the philosophical references that I'm using and the philosophical thinking that I'm applying is very rare in the football world, because there is no sound philosophical foundation in the football world, like in serious professions. No. In the football world, everybody can think whatever he wants. Everybody can say whatever he wants. Everybody can do whatever he wants, as long as he wins. Yes? So if you win, you are good. If you are not winning, you are bad. Yes, and in the meantime, you can do whatever you want. That's a very low-level world. Yeah, you would almost feel sorry for that world. Yes, you would almost feel sorry for the football world with all these subjective people, with all their totally arbitrary thoughts, with their totally arbitrary coaching. Yes. It's very difficult to take that seriously. So the challenge now is that we are going to say, okay, stop till here and no further. Let's establish a universal football language first. Let's establish philosophically correct football references first. And then talk about football. Yeah, in other words, let's create an alphabet first, so the building blocks. Let's create grammar first, protocols, and then talk about football. Yes? But what is happening now in the football world is that everybody has his own alphabet. Everybody has his own grammar rules. And still these people try to communicate with each other. That's very funny. Yes, but it is the football world in a nutshell. And that is why you have these endless subjective discussions that are going absolutely nowhere, because one subjectivity is not better than another subjectivity. It is subjective status quo. So these subjective discussions will last forever. So these people will keep each other busy for the rest of their lives. But in the meantime, we are not going to get anywhere unless we raise the bar and say, okay, let's create objective references and universal language.
Raymond, I mean, I think when you sit back and just grasp what you broke down, what you discuss, it's so deep, it's so meaningful in the way you perceive it, because, you know, sometimes that mask layers, the mask of winning, layers a lot of problems, a lot of situations where you're discussing how valuable those three components are and how we have to be pushing it and incorporating it within a system. And it kind of sets me up going to our next question, and including yourself, Raymond, and the people you have come upon, players, you know, coaches, organizations, top flight. You have worked with the most elite at the highest level, you know, and you have, and this is including yourself as well. What is the mindset? I want to get more into the mentality now, transitioning from periodization, from the fitness, physical aspect, getting more into mindset, discussing what is it that for the viewers that never were in that environment, in that elite. You know, I know the media portrays these top teams, top football, but they are the reason they are where they are. They are the most highest level. I want to know, when you go in there, communicate with those certain individuals of players, coaches, anyone within those organizations, what is it that makes them elite? What is it, the mentality part? What is it that makes them stand out? What is it that makes them work the way they do? What time do they wake up? What time do you guys come into the office? What time do you leave the office? You know, what are the qualities that stands out mentally in those individuals that you've come upon, that you work with daily as well? If we can kind of break into that.
Well, you use the word mindset. So it's very, very important to have a common definition of the word mindset. So let's use, when you talk about mindset, the way of thinking, yeah, the way they think. And what is also very important is that it doesn't necessarily, it's not necessarily relevant to analyze their how, because they will all coach in a different way. Yes, so because they all have different personalities, they all react to situations in a different way. So what is very important, if you want to answer that question, is that you don't get stuck at the level of the how, but that you go to the level of the what. Yeah? So the level of the what is about intentions. What do you try to achieve? Yeah? And the level of the how is the behaviors, how you try to accomplish your intentions. And in their behaviors, all these coaches are different, because they're all different people. But in their intentions, they are the same. So it is very important to analyze and compare these coaches at the level of the what, the intentions. And don't be distracted by the level of the how, the behaviors. But that's very difficult. You know why? The behaviors is basically all you see. And as they say in psychology, what you see is all there is. Yeah, so the behaviors, the how, is all I see. So as a result, it's all there is. So let's discuss the behaviors. Let's discuss the how. Yeah, and then you end up in a subjective, chaotic world. What you need is the ability to theorize what you are looking at, and to extrapolate the what, the intentions. And what many of those coaches have in common is that they are knowledgeable, but they don't use their knowledge as the objective. No, they use it as a tool, and their players are the objective. So the knowledge is a tool to improve their players. The knowledge has to adapt to the situation. What is the mistake that, for example, young coaches make, or inexperienced coaches? they use knowledge as an objective in itself. They have been to a course, they have read a book, they are very enthusiastic about a certain piece of information, and now they're going to apply it for the sake of applying it. And now, as a result, they apply the knowledge, and now the players are tools to execute the knowledge. So now the players have to adapt to the knowledge, rather than the knowledge adapting to the players. So a lot of coaches, especially young, but coaches in general, they make the mistake that their thinking is the starting point. Their thinking is the objective. And that the players are tools to perform whatever the coach has visualized. So now the players are numbers, the players are soldiers who have to adapt to the thinking of the coach. Really good coaches, they do it the other way around. They first look at the situation, what do I have? Very patiently, very gradually, they look what they have. And of course, they have their thinking. But they use their thinking only as a reference point. Okay, hey, these people I can use. These people will be counterproductive, so maybe they have to go. Hey, now still one or more pieces of the puzzle are missing. So I have to bring in one or more players or one or more staff members until you have all the pieces of the puzzle that you need to accomplish whatever goal. So the first group of people that I discussed, that, and that's the majority, they are top, they try to top down control the situation. Their thinking is the rule, the starting point, and the people have to follow the thinking of the coach. That is what you call top down control. My way or the highway. The second group, and that group is smaller, and those are predominantly the really good coaches, I describe top-down guidance. You still use your knowledge top-down, but only to guide the people on the working floor. And this difference between top-down control and top-down guidance is the most dominant, the biggest difference between successful coaches and unsuccessful coaches. And obviously, the next step is, okay, based on what information am I gonna top-down guide a process? Because if the quality of information in your brain is relatively low or little, you are doing top-down guidance, which is good, but it will be ineffective after all, because the top-down guidance is based on a relatively low-quality knowledge and information. So you are guiding people based on arbitrary information. So step one, top-down guidance instead of top-down control. But then the next step is top-down guidance based on what? Not opinions, not past experiences, no. Top-down guidance based on objective knowledge. And then we are back to square one again, because I mentioned top-down, I mentioned objective knowledge already a few times in this conversation. What people who are listening or watching to this conversation, the biggest takeaway, the number one lesson of this conversation should be that you do not pollute your brain with subjective and arbitrary information. And in the last 4 months, when everybody was locked up at home, we have been bombarded by a tsunami of subjective and arbitrary information on the internet. And it was all with good intentions. Yeah, so it was not with bad intentions. I mean, everybody had good intentions, but 99.9% of the information that was for free available on the internet in the last 4 months is very arbitrary and subjective information. That is what you call brain pollution. People should protect themselves against subjective brain pollution. You should only download objective, reliable information. Yeah, so, for example, as you know, because the physical courses will be difficult in the upcoming months, on September 1, I will start with a one-year online mentorship. And the only thing I will do is try to improve people's thinking. I'm not going to share recipes. I'm not going to share exercises. I am not going to share the flavor of the month. I'm not going to share anecdotes. Yes. No, what I'm going to share is how people can become independent thinkers. Yeah, so you download objective information in your brain, and then you anticipate on the external factors in your situation in your way and not in somebody else's way. And the starting point is knowledge. So don't pollute your brain with arbitrary information. Only download objective, reliable information. And then based on that objective information, you can top down guide your players. And as a result, the players will take ownership of that process, because for them, it feels like their process. You are not squeezing it through their throat. So you are now encouraging self-regulation, first in terms of self-regulating players, but at some stage they are going to coach each other and hold each other accountable, and then gradually you develop to a self-regulating team, all based on top-down guidance based on objective knowledge, rather than top-down control based on subjective, arbitrary brain pollution.
Raymond, I mean, it feels like we can go for hours. We can talk all day with the amount of quality dialogue we're having here. I want to kind of go into a point within this mindset and an experience. Before we close it out with our last question, and then also let you close us out with anything you have going on going forward as well. My section that I want to kind of transition to, it revolves around mindset, and I want to discuss more about your experience. From the outside in, even the perception I had and viewing in, with the late Gary Speed that you worked with at Wales, to me, when I'm looking from the outside, it was a very unique experience that you've had as a coach, because you're going in, working with Gary Speed, unfortunate situations happen. You're in a situation where you can be appointed a head coach as well. Obviously, political organization things happen too. With something that you experienced like that, how do you deal mentally, mindset-wise, and in a professional stature to, deal with an environment like that?
Well, like you said, it was indeed a unique situation. It is something that I will treasure for forever, because it was very obvious that that we had something special going on. And thankfully, in the Euro 2016, eventually, the Welsh team reached the semi-final, fulfilling their potential because that is a unique generation of players. But when we started in 2011, it was hard work because the Welsh FA, the FAW, they had their way of doing things, which was part of the problem and the fact that they had not qualified for 50 years. So one of the things that Gary Speed did was basically isolating the national team from the football association. So he was basically cutting the ties with the people from the federation so that they could no longer negatively influence the process because they wanted to be hands-on and they wanted to make decisions and etc. And yeah, then on the one hand, that was very successful. But on the other hand, what you also could predict is that when that journey unfortunately ended, when Gary Speed sadly lost his life, yeah, it was very predictable that that the FAW would try to claim their lost territory back, if you understand what I mean. And what happened next was a very nasty situation, but it was a fantastic learning experience, because the thing is that I never intended to be the head coach, for the simple fact that I don't have my pro license. So even if I want, I cannot be the head coach, because you can only be the head coach if you have a pro license diploma, and I don't have that ambition, so I never went on that course. And the fantastic learning experience is the fact that what I said publicly is, let the other, the Welsh assistant coach, and me, we can take over. So I also mentioned the other assistant coach, because he has a pro license and he was also the technical director of the federation. So then he was capable, or he had the license to be the head coach, and I could then stay in my role as the assistant, exactly the same role as with Gary. And the funny thing is that because the players, they were pushing me in the media to take over, because they didn't know that I did not have my pro license and I did not have that ambition. So what you then saw is that all former international players of Wales who are now working in the media, they did not want the first ever foreign national team coach. And they also did not know that I did not have my pro license. So they were terrified by the idea that I would become the Welsh coach. And then what is the best way to reduce the chance of a foreigner being appointed? Yeah, destroy him. So although I said, let's take him and me take over, they still said, hey, he's applying for the head coach job. And people can still go back on my timeline and check those tweets. And you can literally see what I read. I said, let him and me take over instead of let me take over. But yeah, and that is also a learning moment for me, because you always have to be critical about your own approach and ask yourself the question, what could I have done better to make myself less vulnerable for these people with bad intentions, because they don't want a foreigner, they want old boys network, they want one of their former teammates to be the next national team coach, which is what happened eventually. You always have to ask yourself the question, what could I have done better in that situation. And one of my conclusions is that I should not even have said it publicly. I mean, if the players want something, let them say it. Yes, I don't have to say it myself. And probably because I was emotionally evolved, when something sad like this happens, you probably are not 100% reflecting consciously and rationally. So there are probably also some emotions evolved or involved. And we're all human beings, so I should not be too harsh on myself. But that's a very good lesson. That's a very good lesson. Let the players, if the players want something, let them say it. There's no need for me to say it as well. Yeah, I had good intentions, and it's also probably because deep inside I knew that Gary's legacy would be broken down by the FAW because they wanted to win their territory back that Gary had taken off them. So I understand why things went the way they went. But I have learned some lessons from that, which is very, very valuable. I think with experiences like that, you learn something that normally takes you 5 or 10 years to learn. And so although the situation was very sad, it also accelerates your own development, which is at the end of the day, and not only as a coach, but also as a human being, at the end of the day, yeah, that is what it's all about.
I totally agree. And I think one of the things I wanted to kind of touch with that unique experience was, positive or negative from the outside perception, it was a positive learning experience nonetheless, because you went through it and you evaluated it. Because also you discussed how as human beings we make mistakes, yeah, but there's a lot of things, you know, that's happening behind the scenes that we don't. And whenever people feel afraid of something and they feel a certain situation, I think they paint the story maybe not to its fullest. And that's the unique approach of media. I think in the end of the day, the negativity stories sell and everybody has to have their certain spin on it. But I think overall, that's a huge thing you even said on the players. If the players want it, or even if you're in a regular company, if the company wants you, they'll step up to it. It doesn't, you don't have to go public and say, oh, I want that public or something like that. But there are moments with it. And I think we're all human beings. We're all acting on emotions. But you never, and I think that's one of the biggest things I respect of you as an individual, is you never shy away from moments. And you voice your opinions on them. And I think that's a huge, huge, huge thing. Even at the highest level, some individuals still don't do either. I appreciate this. I think it's been a great dialogue. I want to get into our last question. This is a fun one we do for all our speakers, all our guests. And it explains where they kind of grew up within it. We try to say, discuss the question of favorite team of all time, favorite player of all time. And we always put the open notion of, it doesn't have to be in the world of football, but if our guest speaker or guest are within the world of football, usually it does. And the reason I say that, because everyone's childhood, sometimes it's a childhood team, it's a childhood player, there's a different story behind it. And one of the reasons I want to give you the green light of any freedom, this, pick your favorite player of all time and favorite team of all time, is how did it come about? How did that team or player come about in your personal life?
Yeah, when I think about favorite team, two teams pop up, and that is the 95 Ajax team with Louis van Gaal. Hmm. And it's the Barcelona team with Guardiola. Hmm. And you probably recognize the similarities between those two. And then I if I have to choose between the two, I go for the Ajax team of 95 winning the Champions League, because what they did is more difficult than what Barcelona did with Guardiola. Still an unbelievable unbelievable achievement, because I think that they have played with Messi, Xavi, Iniesta and all the other guys. I think they probably have played the best football we have seen so far in our lives. So in absolute terms, what they have done is of a higher level. But I still go for the Ajax team. But obviously that's very subjective. First of all, because it's a smaller team with smaller budgets, with unknown players rather than the best players in the world. And they were very young. And of course, because as a child, I was watching them. I was in the stadium and I've seen it as a teenager with my own eyes, which obviously makes an unbelievable impression when you see your home team, because I'm born and raised in Amsterdam. When you see your hometown team be so successful at the highest level, and you are a teenager, that makes an impression for the rest of your life. And when you talk about best player, then that's very simple. That's Lionel Messi, of course. Because, I don't think that there is anyone who can even get close to his abilities. For other reasons, Cristiano Ronaldo is obviously very successful. Because he matched Messi in terms of goals, which is ultimately what it's about. But I think in terms of communication, decision and execution, I would go for Lionel Messi. And if I also think about the best coach, then I have to choose between Gus Hiddink and Louis van Gaal. And van Gaal is similar to me, and Gus Hiddink is the opposite of me. So I then think I go for Gus Hiddink, because as the opposite of me, I have learned more in terms of the areas that are underdeveloped with me and overdeveloped with him. While when you work with somebody like Louis van Gaal, and as a person you are pretty similar to somebody like him, he will encourage you and further develop you in areas that are already dominant within you. So van Gaal helped me to develop my dominant abilities to an even higher level. And Gus Hiddink helped me to develop my underdeveloped abilities, because Gus Hiddink is more like a people's manager and Louis van Gaal is more like a tactical teacher. So Louis van Gaal helped me to become an even better teacher. And Gus Hiddink helped me to develop my underdeveloped people's management abilities. And that is for me favorite team, favorite player, favorite coach, in combination with the personal touch.
I want to kind of quickly, since you brought it up, and it's great that you brought it up. I know we dissected Gus Hiddink at the beginning. What if there's a story or there's a moment we can quickly touch on with Louis van Gaal? What's a story or an experience you've had and you're like, you know what, when you ever always look back, you're like, Louis van Gaal, he's something else too. And I know you said he's a great teacher, but what is it that made him so special too?
He is the only coach I've seen with my own eyes, and I've seen many, who was able to make a team better in one session. That is very rare.
How?
Because he's very clear. You can see that he can visualize how it should look. So his tactical knowledge is unprecedented. So that is at team level. At individual level, he has a very sharp eye for details. So communication, decision, execution. And within decision making and execution, also the position, the moment, the direction, and the speed of the action. And besides his analytical abilities, he also has the methodological ability to step by step, very, very clearly, take players by the hand and let them improve within 60 minutes. Sometimes you can almost not believe what you're seeing, because he knows what he wants. He's very clear in his coaching, very methodological, and on top of that, he is also then he lets himself go, if you understand what I mean. And you have seen those pictures, and you can see it on YouTube, that he is enthusiastic like a child. But then the players, they see, although it might look strange, because it's very rare that an adult, let alone a top coach, let himself go that much. But on the other hand, the players see that it is sincere, that he really means it. So they have a connection with him. It's contagious. And so now the players want to push even more. They want to also do it for him. And all these things that I just summarized together results in a coach improving a team in one session. So just imagine this coach working like that with a team for 40 sessions. That's going to be a good team. Yeah. And that's why he's so good. No. And obviously, with one team, he has been more successful than with others. Because, for example, with Man United, although they have qualified for the Champions League and although they won the FA Cup, etc., it was not how he had hoped it would be. Because, yeah, there are always external factors that independent of how good you are and independent on how hard you try to anticipate on it, sometimes it's simply out of your control. And then you have to keep your head up high and accept it. That sometimes you cannot bend iron with your bare hands. So, I think he handled that situation and all the backstabbing. I think he handled that very well. So, yeah. So, Louis van Gaal, in a nutshell, in one sentence, is a coach who can improve a team dramatically in one session.
Wow. And I really love the whole analogy of you cannot bend an iron with hands. And that's so important. And, you know, you have to accept it. And it doesn't, and some people, because you're like, wow, Louis van Gaal couldn't do what Alex Ferguson did at Man United. And that's not the case. That's not the case. Louis van Gaal is an exceptional coach, and he's in the same table as those coaches as well. It's just every environment complements a different coach. Every organization, you need to have the office behind you. You need to have everything. It's a team effort. Football is not a golf sport. It's a team sport, and it needs that. And I want to kind of bring it back and say, thank you so much, Raymond. I mean, it was truly an honor, truly a pleasure, very intriguing dialogue. And I want to kind of put it back on you and allow you to close us out by sharing with us anything you have going in the future for our viewers to know about, teams you're working with, projects you have going on. And kind of from there, we'll close it out and close our interview.
Yeah, the only thing I would like to mention, and I already mentioned it during our conversation, is that for those coaches who are watching worldwide, on September 1, I will start a one-year online mentorship. Because in the past, not everybody was able to join our courses worldwide, either because the course was not in their country or because they were not able to travel to Europe for the five-day courses. So to take away all the boundaries for everybody around the world, we have decided to start with a one-year online mentorship, which means that for 12 months, each month there will be one topic, so 12 topics, from football tactics to technique training, fitness, periodization, psychology, but also strength training and rehabilitation. And besides the one-hour course each month, there's also going to be Q&As based on the questions of the delegates. So after watching a one-hour course on a specific topic, it's inevitable that you have follow-up questions, and there will be Q&As to answer those questions. And delegates will also receive my new football coaching theory book that I published last or 2 weeks ago. And for those who want to join us, they can go to the website fcevolution.com. So fcevolution.com, and you can find all the details in relation to this 1 year online mentorship. And the last thing I would like to add to that is that only register if you are looking for objective knowledge, and don't register if you will prefer, like I said before, the flavor of the month or subjective opinions or anecdotes, because you are not going to find those in our online course. So I always looking forward to have people in front of me or following me who try to raise the bar in football from an objective and philosophical point of view. And hopefully this way we can raise the bar and develop a new generation of coaches who approach coaching football in a more professional way. Because if people are ill, yeah, what doctor do they prefer? Mm. Do they go to the doctor with a lot of medical knowledge, or do they go to a doctor with a lot of medical experience? Well, and as you probably recognize, yeah, most people, because they don't want to die, they probably go to the doctor with a lot of medical knowledge. Yeah, so in normal life, knowledge is of a higher order than experience. And it doesn't mean that experience is not important, because experience is also valuable, but knowledge is of a higher order than experience in normal life, if you have to choose between those two doctors. And it should be the same in football, yes? But unfortunately, in football, we work in a sport where people who have played 100 games for the national team, they are higher in the food chain than people who are very, very knowledgeable. So that's the world upside down. So with my books and with my courses, I present not subjective experiences and anecdotes, but objective knowledge. And hopefully with that objective information, we can develop a generation of coaches who are very knowledgeable and on top of that also experienced, so that players can also choose a knowledgeable coach and not only a coach with a lot of experience, so that they have the same choice like we have when we are ill and when we wanna choose the doctor with a lot of medical knowledge. So hopefully there will be plenty of coaches all around the world who are hungry for knowledge, and they can join us, fcevolution.com. We start September 1, and hopefully we see each other there.
Fantastic. And I think one of the importance is having this dialogue with you. Behind every education is the people behind it. And Raymond, when I'm having this dialogue, and for our viewers that will listen to it too, is, you know, this dialogue explains what your FC Revolution is about. You know, you are a very knowledgeable person. And I actually, it's funny how you said experience and knowledge. In a nutshell, based on this, I think you are a complementary of both. And I want the viewers to know that, because sometimes they register and they spend money on certain aspects of education, but it's not that quality within. It might be a good little diploma license against the wall behind you that says, hey, be proud of that. But when you look at the deeper thing, did it really challenge you? Did it really get you over the top? And I feel, based on our conversation and getting to know you more, is your organization is providing that. And I want the viewers to know that it's going to be second to none, that kind of education. And it's going to be something that it's going to help our game grow. Again, thank you so much.